This afternoon, we are announcing that Connecticut has entered into an agreement in principle with Juul.
In the US, Juul, one of the country's dominant manufacturers of vape and e-cigarette products, agreeing to a massive payout with 34 states and territories, settling a lawsuit claiming it marketed its product to children and teens.
The agreement calls for a payment of at least $438.5 million.
But it's not just about money. Juul can no longer advertise on billboards, public transport, social media, or pay influencers.
Juul cannot depict persons in any marketing under the age of 35. They can't use cartoons like Joe Camel. No paid product placement in movies or television shows.
Once upon a time, it was normal for cartoon characters like the Flintstones or Joe Camel to spruik cigarettes to a younger audience. An outcry in the 90s forced an end to these practices, but e-cigarettes are a different beast altogether, and the online world has upended traditional media channels.
You have all these different social media channels where you look at TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat. It's not a traditional ad, you know, it's a lot of organic user-created content, and we don't even perceive it as advertising in the first place.
In Australia, it's illegal to sell or supply any vaping product to children, and nicotine vaping products are only available by prescription, with a strict ban on how they can be marketed. But in the age of global social media, marketing bans only go so far.
You smoke and you pull it into your lungs.
It's not just marketing that's easily subverted. Laws restricting vape sales have had little impact, with black market supplies thriving. The AMA says 20% of 18 to 24-year-olds have used an e-cigarette, despite having never smoked.
I think rules can always be tightened, but let's be careful not to prohibit as well, because when we prohibit things, we know that black markets emerge, and then, unfortunately, we have young people consuming vape products that are unsafe to be used in the first place because they come from dodgy manufacturers.
So, are we doing enough to stop a new generation from making the same mistakes?
I mean, that $438 million US sounds like a lot of money for them to pay as a penalty for what they've been doing, but that's only a quarter of their sales in the last 12 months. So this is big ticket business.
Exactly right. And I just keep thinking with vaping, it's so interesting that I read something the other day that said generationally, no generation wants to do the same drug their parents did. And so it feels as though nicotine has had to be rebranded as something that you equate vaping with youth now. And so they've got to make it uncool all over again. And of course, if it's on TikTok and, you know, it's on all the social media platforms, what difference do regulations make to advertising?
So I guess that what that means is it's not the fine that matters here. It's the rules around advertising, because that's, I mean, especially not being able to sponsor hosts or influencers.
But that's fine locally, but the international influencers, their feed still comes.
Oh, for us, yeah, but for that company not to be able to do it.
Yeah.
Presumably, I don't know, unless they can do it from another country. I don't know how that would work, but it seems like they're not going to be able to do it. The question would be, and I don't know if there's anyone knows the answer to this, but how many of those vaping videos are paid influencers and how many are just, it's become a bit of a trend on TikTok anyway, and so that's just going to be the thing.
It's an organic trend, and I just don't think you can obviously police that. People, you know, will start to just do it, or a, you know, funny way to vape or whatever, and then that goes viral on its own without any commercial backing.
So what you're saying is we need to wait for the next generation, like Generation Alpha or whatever, to say it's uncool.
Yes.
And then it'll stop.
Exactly.
Okay, good. This sounds like a plan. Yeah.